have a bad news and I have a good news. Bad news first. Cancer is here to stay. One man in three, one woman in four will be faced with the diagnosis. And by 2020, 15 million of citizens of this planet will be confronted to the disease. Cancer is the result of aging population. We are victims of the success of other fields of medicine. We die less of cardiovascular disease, of diabetes, of measles, of tetanus, and we are there to develop cancer. Cancer is the result of aging of our cells, which acquire genetic alteration, dysfunctioning. They are not hereditary. Only 5% of cancer are hereditary. But I have good news for you. Cancer is no longer a death sentence. We have made tremendous progress. I was graduated as a medical doctor in 1974. And I remember vividly how heartbreaking it was, or difficult, with great emotion, to pose a diagnosis of cancer and to tell a patient that he had cancer, causing for that person, but also his or her entourage, tremendous distress, anxiety, apprehension, fear of death. And that is the reason why in 1974 I decided to dedicate my professional life to the improvement of quality of life and survival of patients with cancer. The good news is that over 40 years of my medical career, I have witnessed so tremendous progress. If you want to see, look at the decrease of cancer mortality in Europe over the last 40 years, both for men and women, and also the dramatic increase of survival in the United States. Why did we make so much progress? First, because we better understand what causes cancer, thanks to basic research. We understand what is going on a cellular level. It is philosophically very interesting to realize that all our cells are programmed to die. It's the phenomenon that we call apoptosis. And if we develop cancer, it's because one of our cells has found the secret of immortality and does not die, multiply in an anarchic way, disseminate and create metastasis. The second reason why we are making so much progress is that we have much better and earlier diagnostic tool, which means that it is much easier to treat cancer today. And the third factor is that it's thanks to thousands of patients who trusted us, clinical investigators, and who accepted to participate in what we call clinical research or human experimentation. Indeed, curing mice and rats in laboratory does not help the patient at the bedside. To transfer the research results from basic research to the bedside, we need to do what we call clinical research. And I want to pay tribute to those thousands of patients, thanks to them, that we are here today with the progress that we have made over the last 40 years. But cancer is a heterogeneous disease. There are more than 100 types of cancer. Overall, today, 55% of patients are cured. But the difference is, for example, for childhood cancer, we have a dramatic decrease both in Europe and in the United States. But there are still some diseases which are very difficult to treat. Although we are curing 95% of patients with testis cancer, 90% of women with breast cancer and Hodgkin's disease, some cancer like melanoma, pancreatic cancer, lung cancer remain difficult. But I have great hope that in the coming years, we are going also to make progress for those cancers. But treating cancer is not an easy way for the patient. He has to go through a very difficult path, himself and his entourage as well, to get surgery, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, immunotherapy, and so on. It's an ordeal. It's painful. It's requiring strength. And when we, doctor, we say to a patient, after 5 years, you are cured, we don't need to see you and to make so much follow-up tests anymore, the patient expects to enjoy a better life, a normal life, but they cannot. They are confronted to a lot of social, new problems, totally unexpected. This is totally unacceptable. It's outrageous. A few examples at the workplace. Try to think how you would react in front of somebody that you need to hire and who tell that he has cancer. To get a job, to get a promotion, this remains a lot of stigma. It's still very difficult to get back to a normal life. Those former patients also face tremendous difficulties to get loan and mortgage, financial burden. Here I want to give the testimony of a young woman, 38-year-old, successful lawyer who had brain surgery and still active in a very large law company. She wanted to buy a home. She was denied to have a loan because of her previous surgery for cancer. She told us, "I had the feeling to pay twice." Those former patients also face problems for insurance, all types of insurance, medical one, that either I denied or provide as astronomical cost. And here I want to give the testimony of Sir Peter Jonas, who is a world famous director of opera in Chicago, in London, in Munich, who is still extremely active. He is now 70 years old. He got Hodgkin's disease at the age of 25. For the last 45 years, he never got health insurance. So, facing all of those problems, I decided that although we know that bank and insurance are risk-averse, I decided to dedicate the last part of my life to try to solve and improve the problem, to create awareness. I have created Cancer Survivorship Summit, where we meet and we discuss to get the testimony and several research projects. The action plan is first at the workplace. You could also help increasing awareness. Contact your human resource department, creating supporting programs. Those progress don't come overnight. The solution will not come from the sky. We should also change the rules, adapt the legal framework. This requires a political will. It is cynical. In 2016, it seems easier to cure cancer than to reform bank and insurance. In France, there is a law, droit à l'oubli, right to be forgotten, which is a very good law. That means that an adult do not have to declare to an insurance company that he had cancer 10 years after the end of treatment and 5 years for a child. We should expand this law, all countries. And finally, we are facing a paradigm shift for the business world. There are 32 million cancer survivors. Survivor meaning no recurrence or relapse 5 years after the end of treatment. And many, many more will come every year thanks to the progress that we are making, we, medical doctors, clinical investigators. So the society has to move, speed up the paradigm shift, be the promoter of the evolution. the patient should not be left alone, go to a second ordeal. You should not pay to be a survivor. I have a dream for those former patients. Survive and thrive. It's time for all of us to have vision, action, solution, creativity, to make sure that they enjoy a better life, a normal life. It's time to bring value to those former patients, but mainly to mankind. Thank you.